for that introduction. I'm not sure that I can live up to it. 15 minutes isn't a whole lot of time. So what I'm going to do is talk through three recent innovations in content delivery, discovery, and monetization, and just give you an idea of the kinds of things that we're looking at and seeing in the industry, not just professional and scholarly publishing, but across the wider media industry as well. And we'll start with delivery. So 1 year for a human is 7 years for a dog, although I just learned that that's not actually strictly true. Dogs age very quickly when they're young, and you know, anyway, 7 years for a dog, but a lifetime for mobile technology. And you know, I'm really thrilled to be speaking at this conference again. I spoke last year, and I gave a presentation titled "Why HTML5 is In and Native is Out," and I was talking about how HTML5 web apps are superior to native mobile applications for a number of reasons. And I said that, you know, it has reduced time to market and cost. You're developing one app across all of these different operating systems instead of having to develop different ones. You can reach every modern OS, and you can also reach the browser. You know, when someone types in your website URL in the browser, if you only have an app, then they're going to get that unoptimized experience. That was another reason that HTML5 was great. And I also said that there were no trade-offs. You weren't losing anything if you dropped your native apps or didn't pursue native apps and instead used HTML5. Now, I want to revisit that last point today because a year is a lifetime in mobile technology, and something happened since I gave that presentation last year. And that was that Apple released iOS 5, the latest version of their operating system. And one of the major features of that operating system update is the newsstand. So many of you are probably familiar with this. And the main benefits of the newsstand, first and foremost, it downloads new content in the background. And this is a major selling point for publishers who are looking to get their content to users on mobile devices in a very seamless way. All of the solutions in the past have been, you know, fairly clunky. You can open the app and you can cache the latest issue. Financial Times developed an HTML5 web app, but again, you need to open it up in the browser, you need to download the latest issue. So you can't just grab the iPad when you're leaving for your morning commute and have everything with you, all the latest content. Newsstand solves that problem. It actually pushes the content to you in the background. You don't need to do anything. And iCloud, which is Apple's cloud-based solution, syncs your newsstand apps across your devices. So if you download a publisher's app on your iPhone, it's going to put it, assuming that you've configured it to work this way, on your iPad and your iPod Touch and so on and so forth. So it's a really interesting delivery mechanism that's been introduced. And you know, we have to think about whether or not this is one of those killer apps. We've heard about new ways of delivering content to users before. RSS was supposed to eliminate the need for email table of contents alerts, and that hasn't come to pass. But a couple you know, things are really interesting about newsstands, and here's a statistic from paidcontent.org. Condé Nast reported a 268% growth in new subscriptions after moving to newsstand compared with the previous 8 weeks. So there are some pretty compelling statistics showing that this can lead to some serious usage growth and revenue growth. But there are a number of publishers who have adopted newsstands sort of early on, and it's possible that as more publishers put their apps in newsstands, that economy is going to normalize because it's not so easy to find any particular app in the newsstand. But it's an interesting thing to consider. And one of the things that newsstand has done really well is that lean back versus lean forward experience. And the newspapers are read differently than professional and scholarly content. That is almost universally true. But what the iPad and other tablet devices are teaching us is that users will start to read content, all different types of content, in a different way when they have it in their hands. And newsstands really fits into that pattern of behavior by pushing the content to the users and just putting it in that format that they've been showing that they're willing to engage in. You have to play by Apple's rules, and what that means is that you either need to offer subscriptions through the newsstands, through the iTunes store, and give up 30%, or you have to not sell a subscription through your app at all. All that you can do is provide a sign-in. You can't even put a link that brings them out of the app to subscribe. So that's another thing to consider. And there is an additional cost of development. You know, I still feel very strongly, and my company still feels very strongly about HTML5 being the right path for publishers to develop mobile apps. But this represents a shift in the dynamics for iPad in particular, where publishers might need to reevaluate that and think about developing a new STEM-compatible app. So that's one thing that's going on in delivery. Next is discovery. And if we look at the last 10 years, we are stuck with the same old information architecture that we've been using since journals first went online. And what I mean by that is that you have a list of journals, you click on a journal and you get a list of issues, you click on an issue, you get a table of contents, you click on a table of content, an article and a table of contents, and you get an article. And the same pattern for books, right? It follows the print, and it's really boring, actually. You just see lists of articles everywhere. And some publishers have tried to break up the monotony. This is a screenshot from the American Chemical Society's website. I think this is the current issue of their flagship journal. And they introduced what they call this grid view, which breaks up the monotony of that long list. And current issues of JAX have about 100 articles each. So you can imagine what it's like to discover the content that's interesting to you if every single week this one journal is publishing 100 articles. So this presents a much more compelling way for users to discover whether or not the content is interesting to them. Right? Other publishers are doing some similar things. But we've had this old information architecture, and along came touch, multi-touch interface that we all rely on so much on our phones now. And it started with the iPhone. And there were touch devices before the iPhone, but Apple really revolutionized the touch interface. And then the iPad was introduced early last year. And the touch user interaction model has given us the ability to create really amazing new information architectures. So this is Flipboard, which you may be familiar with. And what Flipboard does is it aggregates content from a number of different sources, and then it presents it in a much more compelling interface, and it really takes advantage of that large touch surface because you can swipe away the articles you aren't interested in, you can make them full size, half column. It's a very compelling model, and Flipboard is now valued at something ridiculous like $500 million. Which is neither here nor there, but we can use the Flipboard user experience as a model for how to transform the journal information architecture. Start to do something a little more compelling and start to make it easier for users to discover the content that's actually relevant to them. You know, presenting long lists segmented by journal doesn't really do the trick. So what Flipboard allows you to do at its core is see what's new, relevant, and important right away. And we can replicate that in the journals environment by leveraging things like taxonomic enrichment and recommendation engines. So take into account all of the usage that we record when users are using various pieces of content and other users are using content and make recommendations. And efficiently skip what the user is not likely to be interested in. You know, this is a key thing that, in general, publishers are not doing a very good job of right now. They just present content in lists, and they don't separate what the user is actually going to be interested in from what is just being published alongside what the user might be interested in. So what we're looking at doing, and we haven't done this yet, is to take the Flipboard user experience and inject into it the usage that we're observing and the semantic enrichment that we're receiving from our clients or generating on our own, and all of the other behavioral characteristics of the pattern of the content and the platform, and delivering a better information architecture. And in case you thought that this opportunity was limited to mobile devices, iPhone and iPad and other competitors, keep in mind that if you buy a new Mac today, you're given the choice between getting an all-touch mouse or a touch pad. Okay, so this is not actually confined to devices that you can just put in your hands and walk around with. And Apple is also not the only hardware manufacturer which is really embracing touch, or software manufacturer. The next version of Windows, the next major version, which is Windows 8, has touch built in from the ground up. So touch, the point is that touch is everywhere. It's not just limited to mobile devices. And it's really changing the user's expectations for interaction and discovery. Now, you just think about how much more efficient it is to have your hands be on a touch surface and move your finger just a little bit, and how much faster you can dispatch with the articles that you're not interested in and cluster together the articles that you are. It's really challenging this list, this boring list and purely text-based solution that most of us have. So it's really pushing us towards a new information architecture, which will promote discovery quite a bit. So that's discovery. And the third thing I want to talk about is monetization. And let's again look at the last 10 years. There has been a relentless focus on institutions, on signing up those big deals, on making sure that all of the consortia are lined up. And the individuals in the process of lining up all of these institutions have become very empowered, because the institutions make the purchasing decisions based on the counter reports. And the counter reports are just an aggregation of what the individuals are doing with the subscriptions. But publishers are not really proactively reaching out to the individuals and trying to engage them. And despite what has been a broad increase in coverage, all of these site licenses, all of these big deals, leads to many more users getting access to much more content. In spite of that, denials are up almost across the board. And here's one statistic which I find to be truly remarkable. JSTOR reported that in 2010, they turned away 150 million users. This isn't 150 million attempts to access individual articles, but 150 million sessions where the user came in and they were denied access to the article that they landed on. And in most cases, the vast majority of cases, user turned around and went right out. So while a lot of money comes from these big deals, it's very rewarding to sign a site license for $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, there's a lot that's still being missed. And we're in London, so it's, you know, fair to use a tube-like diagram to illustrate the problem. The problem is this. Publishers have leads coming from all over the place. A lot of those leads come from Google, but they can come from PubMed, they can come from other third parties. And a lot of those users, you know, 150 million in JSTOR's case in 1 year, just hit a paywall immediately. And most users bounce right off. You know, they don't get to be paying customers, they don't get to be long-term paying customers, meaning not just a pay-per-view purchase, they renew their subscription over time. The expected value of a subscription over time is infinitely higher than the expected value from a pay-per-view sale, which is almost always going to be that one sale and nothing more. So you may have heard of the metered model. It's something that the New York Times adopted earlier this year, and the Financial Times has made very successful over a number of years. Users get N accesses per period. So for example, 10 accesses per month, or in the New York Times' case, 20 accesses per month. Every user can come in and get 20 articles per month without paying. It may or may not require registration. When the Financial Times launched this model, they gave users 10 accesses per month without registering, and an additional 10 after they registered per month, and now they don't allow any without registration. And these meters can be targeted to specific users, for example, those who are registered and not, and they can also be layered. So you can get 10 when you're not registered, and once you register, you can get an additional 10. So you can layer them on top. And there are some pretty cool uses for this kind of a model, too. One of the things that has made the New York Times very successful is that they have what Felix Salmon, who's a finance blogger for Reuters, describes as a porous paywall, which means that you can get free accesses in many different ways, not just through the meter. And one of those ways is if you click on a link that's on a social networking site, you're going to get access to that piece of content, and it's not going to count towards your limit. So you can use this same licensing model to give users coming to your site by clicking on a link on Twitter or Facebook metered access. So you can say they're going to get one free access coming from a social networking site per day, for example. So if we go back to the visualization, this is what's happening right now. The users are hitting the paywall. And what metering allows you to do is to extend that engagement over a longer period of time so that you learn more about users and so that you're better equipped to make them an offer that is relevant to them, something which is actually going to be valued by them and which is going to make them, you know, get them to zone four and be a long-term paying customer. So the New York Times, some stats for you, launched the metered model in March of 2010. In the second quarter of this year, they reported 224,000 paid digital subscriptions. And just one quarter later, that had grown by 100,000. So they now have over 325,000 digital subscriptions. And this is, you know, a newspaper. I'm not saying that this is an apples-to-apples comparison. But remember that JSTOR turned away 150 million users. There has got to be a better thing to do with all of those users than bounce them right out the door. So JSTOR is actually going to be implementing something very similar. They're calling it Register and Read. I think that you can read about it on their website. User registers, and after that, they can get access to three articles every 2 weeks. And it's a view-only model, so you can't download the PDF. You can just look at the page images. But their goal is to bring these users in, not to turn them away immediately, and to understand them a bit better. And this is launching soon. And that's monetization. So what's new? Newsstand, it's something that we need to think about. Playing by Apple's rules, it can be difficult. And as I said, I still believe very strongly in the HTML5 approach to app development. But if newsstands really takes off because it gets the content in the user's hands more effectively, more quickly, more seamlessly than anything else, then that's something that needs to be seriously considered. It's increasingly a touch world, and not just on mobile devices, but on all forms of computing devices. And that is going to enable us to have much more compelling information architectures that promote discovery. And there needs to be a renewed focus on the individual, because there's a major opportunity there that publishers are missing out on, but also, it's what's going to drive the institution growth in the future. So that's what's new in 15 and a half minutes. I apologize for going over time.